then I'll try to make sure we get them over to Frank during the question time. Does that sound good, Frank?
That's a great idea. Thanks, okay. Jerry.
All right. Well, we have a couple minutes after 9. We're ready to go. The call is being recorded. So this is Franca Collins from Australia here to do a Acadia introduction. And I'll just go ahead and turn it over to you, Frank.
Thanks, Terry.
You're welcome.
I thought I might start, and I hope people are okay with this. I thought there's a few things that might be a good start or a good return just to clear up. What I refer to is I've had the opportunity to talk with a number of you, and there is a recording about what exactly happens when a judge is leaving the court and returning and exactly how that whole process works. And I thought that would be something relevant as well as useful for those on the call. The other area I would love to be able to cover again is this issue of how do we know that common law is dead? What are exactly the forms of law that we're dealing with? Because there is so much information still out there, especially even the judges saying that common law is operating in the courts. So I thought that would be relevant to clear that up. The other thing I'd like to do is ask for questions, if we can, in terms of people's feedback on how they're going in reading positive law. But I feel I've done a little bit of an injustice by not covering some of the other books of canon law, and especially talking about natural law as well as divine law. So I hope people on the call don't mind. But it is relevant, because without discussing it, without explaining what it is, getting the full picture of what, in fact, these canons are doing, I feel we're not doing full justice. So just to quickly summarize what we've just said then is, firstly, to go back through and talk about some of these mechanics and procedures and knowledge that we've discussed in the past on exactly what judges are doing when they run out of a court. Secondly, talk about this area of common law and how do we know that common law is being abrogated and what are the new forms of law that they're using. And also this area of asking your feedback on positive law, and just a bit of a discussion about natural law and the bigger picture of what we're really trying to achieve in the promulgation of these canons. So I hope the people on the call are okay with that. I hope you find the information useful. And I also look forward for us to be able to interact and ask and answer questions. So I'm looking at, just to let everyone know, we're looking at a maximum of 2 hours, where I really hope to cover these points in the next hour and really leave it open to a good discussion, Q&A contributions for the second hour. So with that in mind, I'd like to get stuck into it. So the first thing I'd like to discuss tonight with you and share with you is just a little bit of a clarification and a recap on this idea of exactly what is a judge doing when they leave the court. But before we get into that, I think it's also relevant to highlight something that we need to understand from the get-go. When you read positive law, one of the things that, particularly when you come to it first off, one of the things that you'll probably immediately strike you is that the definitions that you read in positive law are, in many cases, completely different to what you will find in Black's, in Oxford Dictionary of Law, and in jurisprudence and in definitions within case law. And the reason for that, and we've said this before, but it's important to remind ourselves, the reason the law is so complex is that the Roman system, the parasites, the Khazars, the ruling system does not want people to understand the law except for very few. And in a court, there will only normally ever be one person that has any clue of the law, and that's the judge. Everyone else is supposed to be ignorant, and by being ignorant are, by default, incompetent. And by being incompetent, give the judge a massive advantage in every matter brought before them. Now, this is obviously fraudulent. This is obviously evil. But this is the system. And it's why, by the way, if you've ever seen, and not everyone has seen this, you may have heard this, but when judges get elevated to higher courts, one of the most common things that will happen is that judges from the higher precinct will actually give them collectively a book. Now, it may look like an old and tattered book, but in most cases, what they're in fact giving them is the key. So what happens with law and lawyers is that they spend years and years and years learning procedure and studying all kinds of definitions, and they are required to learn it, and they're required to prove that they know it. What they're learning is they're learning the rubbish and the knowledge intermingled. It's only when they get to the point of becoming a judge or a higher judge will they ever be given the keys to unlock the truth embedded in the lies. So don't ever think that judges know all the law, and certainly don't think that anyone in a court knows what the hell's going on. So before you ever enter a court, if you haven't reversed, if you haven't responded to the summons, the demand, the notice, then under Roman law, they will have converted you into a thing. We've discussed this before, but it's the first point before I get to the actual court. That is to say, if you encounter a court where the judge does have some knowledge, then they will know automatically that you have already been turned into a thing. And by that, you have no rights under maritime. They only have to leave the court, return, and they can simply say to you, if you say another word, we'll hold you in contempt, and you can go to prison for 6 months. And it's lawful under the form of law, under canon law of 1983, which is known commonly as maritime law, then they can do that because you're a thing. So when we go through and we've discussed and we talk about the importance of responding using the ecclesiastical deed poll and establish your standing, it cannot be overemphasized how important that is before you ever arrive to court. But if you happen to arrive to court and you haven't repudiated their claim of turning into a thing by those documents, then the first form of law that you will face is the Uniform Commercial Code of 1933. That's the first form of law. And what they will present that as is common law. But of course, common law was based on things such as common law rights, writs, habeas corpus and others, and the ability to establish your standing and be given the opportunity to establish your standing. But of course, under Uniform Commercial Code, none of those things apply. You are either a owner of property or you're not. If you don't own property, then you have absolutely no standing whatsoever in a commercial court of law. So when you arrive, and assuming that you are lucky enough to get a judge that isn't fully conversant with canon law, they may give you the opportunity to speak. Now, if you do establish your standing this way and establish that you are living, that you are the trustee of a express trust, and please, I hope no one ever goes down the road of saying that you are the trustee and beneficiary or any of these kind of phrases that have been bandied about. You cannot be two officers of the same trust at the same time. You can, in fact, be an executor of a will and then a beneficiary, but not at the same time. So, yes, you establish your standing. You know, I am living. The flesh lives. Blood flows. I am standing here as a trustee of an express trust, here to, you know, hear the accusation. Now, if the judge, as I say, is not conversant in canon law, then they may well entertain this. And if they do, they will understand that under commercial code, if you've gone to them, or better still, if you've gone to them and said, I stand here as I said, as a trustee of a trust, not as surety to the corporate fiction, then that court knows and that judge knows that he has no contract. If you're not surety to the corporate fiction, which is represented by the birth certificate, then he has no jurisdiction. He has to establish a higher jurisdiction. Now, he does it of one of two ways. And when I've spoken before, what I've said to you is that one way they establish it is to run out of the court, literally run out of the court without any notice. And unfortunately, in the past, this was seen as a win, almost kind of like a joke. And you would hear from people around the world that they thought this was funny. A judge leaves, I've scared off the judge. The judge is afraid, and I've won. And in many cases, the bailiffs and other members, officials of the court, play along with this ruse and even say to defendants, oh, well, you might as well leave. They want you to leave, particularly if you've shown any kind of knowledge of the law. They want you to leave. Why? Because that judge has not finished the case. The case has not been suspended. There is no advantage. What the judge is doing is about to re-establish their standing in a higher court when they return. Because when they return, you will no longer be subject to Uniform Commercial Code of 1933. You will be subject to canon law of 1983, or what we know as maritime law. Mare sea timeo fear, fear of the sea, fear of the Holy Sea, the laws of the Holy Sea. And when he returns, he will be converting you, and probably very firmly converting you into a thing. Now, one of the gambles of their courts, and they can only change the form of the court three times. That means they can only leave twice. There is only three forms of law that they have, the highest being Talmudic law now. But here's the problem. Yes, you want to establish your rights. Yes, you want to argue your case. But the odds get higher. Now, under Uniform Commercial Code, the worst thing that they will tend to do is fine you. It's commercial. It's money. All crime is commercial. So there'll be a bond, $1,000 bond or a fine. Of course, if you can't pay it, then they may add further punitive penalties on that. But that's basically what they're dealing with, bonds and generating bonds. But when that court, when that judge returns to that court into the second form of the court, then under canon law, maritime law, the law of salvage, the salvage of things, their strength is now to order the goods to be put in the warehouse being the prison. The odds and the penalty just got higher. And the most common way that that will be presented is to charge you with contempt. So you'll see it as contempt, but really what it is taking the thing, the goods, to the warehouse. Now, if you really want to gamble to the third level and you don't know what's going on, then under Talmudic law, the penalties of Noahide law are pretty, well, let's just say. I mean, the penalty of breaking a Noahide law, if you look at Wikipedia, is death. Now, I'm not saying that they're going to issue a death penalty, but it's on the table if that was what they wanted to do. So the odds get far, far worse when you want to challenge them. So it's very important that all of us understand what we're dealing with. So back to what we're saying. So you're in court. You've established that you in no way are the surety of the corporate fiction of their sister KV trust, evidenced by the birth certificate. You are a trustee of a separate trust. The judge knows straight away he has no jurisdiction because you're not paying surety for the injury. And whenever they write up their charges, it's always against the corporate fiction, always. So if you're not the surety, they have no one there to stand there for the fiction. So the judge will run out of the court. Now, another way they do it, and this is something that we haven't discussed before, and I want to bring it onto the table,